You're listening to the Pace Radio Network, here at paceradio.net.
The views expressed by the individuals during this broadcast are their own opinions, and they may not be the same as those of their group or other organizations they may be involved with.
Man, what's the matter with that cat there?
Must be full of reefer.
Full of reefer?
Yeah, man.
Mean that cat's high?
Feeling.
Sailing.
Feeling light.
We now wander off the beaten path with an update from the Reefer Reporter.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. Hello and welcome to the Reefer Reporters. I'm Cindy Howell.
And I'm Ron McNabb, and we're live here from the Legacy420.com news desk.
Yes, yes, we are. It is January 27th, 2022. Together, Ron and I are going to be bringing your global reefer report here at paceradio.net. Morning, Ron.
Good morning, and how are you this morning?
I'm doing pretty good, thank you. How about yourself?
I'm doing good. I just had a smoke and got my coffee here and ready to go for the day.
Wicked. Wicked. We have 10 stories on tap, 5 before the break, 5 after. So let's get at her. We are over here at the Growth Op. Feel like planting, eating, or smoking cannabis? Ontario Cannabis Store unveils new products.
Yeah, it's a new year, so what better way to look forward to check out the latest offerings at the Ontario Cannabis Store, the OCS. On January 25th, the OCS announced that it would be unveiling 240-plus new products, some of which will be part of the online retailer's ever-increasing stash for cannabis connoisseurs and newbies alike. From dried flower and beverages to extracts and edibles and a selection of unique limited releases. There's something for everyone, the agency assures.
The items are expected to be coming soon to the OCS and select authorized cannabis shops throughout the province. For those interested in cannabis planting, smoking, drinking, and eating, highlights of the new raft of options show that there is something to suit all styles and tastes. The list below includes 5 picks highlighted by the OCS for their innovation, newness, variety, and anticipated appeal. Well, this should be interesting. Cinnamon and cocoa biscuits by THC Kiss. Cannabis lovers or not, I'll take the first one. You can have the second one. What?
Sure.
There's nothing like enjoying a cookie, bringing a twist to traditional tastes like cinnamon and cocoa. THC Kiss has released 2 new biscuits with 1 cookie per package. Morning, afternoon, or evening drinkers will be able to enjoy a 10 milligram THC dip into their preferred drinks. This dish shape of cookies made with a sativa dominant strain allows an even distribution of flavor. Notes information posted on OCS, and you can click there. The treats promise fast-acting effects and no bitter or chemical-like aftertaste. Like, I mean, at 10 milligrams, no, you're not going to taste anything, not at all.
Yeah, it's not a very large dose at all. But then again, some people.
Oh yes,
new people who have never
I'm not saying that it's not a good dose. I mean, because like where I was reset, I could eat like 2.5 of those cookies. Not a big deal.
Yeah.
But like, I mean, like what they mentioned that there's no taste. Well, of course, like at 10 milligrams and the size of a cookie, you're not going to taste a thing.
Yeah, there's not going to be much actual taste in there.
No,
there's more other ingredients than that to mask the flavor.
Yeah.
So the second one is Peanut Butter Mac Live Rosin by Black Market. It's always good to be comfortable, but arguably comfort foods are even better. Peanut butter is one of those relatable and tasty foods. So why wouldn't a cannabis company marry the love of cannabis with that? Black Market decided to do just that with the planned release of its 1 gram Peanut Butter Mac Live Rosin. Made from Black Market's exclusive cultivar, the company's first concentrate offers rich flavors and strong potency. The solventless cold-cured live hash rosin has a nutty flavor with a rich herbal overtone, notes the OCS write-up. Remember, though, this rosin has quite a kick. The highly potent extract is produced from the whole buds of an indica-dominant hybrid that are flash frozen at harvest and comes in a glass jar with a silicone seal.
Oh my dear goodness. I mean, peanut butter breath is one of my favorites, and that looks really, really well done.
Yeah, I've never had peanut butter breath, but I hear that it's a really good strain, and this is something that I would be interested in trying maybe sometime.
Yeah, absolutely. Peanut butter breath, the first time I had it was at a Karma Cup a few years ago, and it just blew my mind. So I grab a hold of it every time I find it, just because I really did enjoy it that much. The third one that they're talking about is Root Beer Float by Bold Growth. Love the taste of root beer. Bold Growth has like-minded customers covered with the release of its rare indica-dominant craft flower that also provides notes of vanilla. The flower is produced by Saskatchewan-based Bold, a small-batch craft cultivator, being a cross with Triple X OG and Vanilla Kush. Root Beer Float's aroma leans earthy with hints of lemon and pine, while the flavor profile is sweet and light herbal with overtones of citrus. I bet you that would be delicious.
Yeah, that's really, really interesting there. Vanilla Kush, I've never had that, but I can imagine that the flavors in this would be just really nice.
Beautiful, yep.
The next one we're moving on to is Golden Pineapple Blunt by Lobo Hemp. For those who want everything done for them, perhaps a pre-roll is in order. Of course, adding a sweet flavor to that pre-roll would only help to bolster the experience. And what sweeter than pineapple? Lobo Hemp will be releasing its new Golden Pineapple Blunt, which provides a rich terpene profile, high THC potency, and absolutely no tobacco. The 1 gram blunt provides compact, amber-flecked, light green buds that are a cross of Golden Goat and Pineapple Kush. The hand-watered, hang-dried hybrid is ground and hand-rolled in a hemp wrap with a glass filter, OCS reports.
Interesting. Yeah. See, here in Nova Scotia, all the flavor, like, you know, blunts and papers are illegal.
No
way.
So
we wouldn't be able to carry. Yeah. You can't buy, completely illegal here. Yeah, it's crazy. So, like, we would never have this in our liquor stores, which are our cannabis stores.
Yeah.
and the fifth one is Purple Number One Seeds by Dutch Passion. I hear wonderful things about Dutch Passion. Feel like getting your hands dirty and doing things on your own? Dutch Passion's new 5-package of Purple Number One Seeds aims to please. Scheduled to launch in February, just in time. The 5-pack of seeds is suited for either indoor or outdoor growing, offering an old-school aroma and earthy, tart, fruity, and spicy flavors. The resulting plants will also provide a feast for the eyes with the purple hue of its blooming flowers. But remember to have enough space to aim high. The plant's 8-week flowering time, large yields, and tall sativa-like height notes OCS. Every purple I grows really, really tall. Just like last November, the OCS released another round of new products. The 150 products includes both regular offerings and limited editions, such as the pineapple habanero hot sauce and 24 karat gold pre-rolls. You can get a full list at that link right there.
Yeah, very interesting.
Very cool. Good time to be in Ontario and get some peanut butter breath live rosin.
Yeah, just waiting for the screen to come up here.
It's
there
coming.
There we go.
Over to Mugglehead Magazine. Tilray launches new medical products and training program in Australia. So this is kind of a Canadian-Australian story.
Yeah. Yeah, after reporting several quarters of disappointing domestic sales, Canadian mega producer Tilray Brands Incorporated is expanding its presence in key international markets like Australia. In a statement Tuesday, the company said 15-gram offerings of its branded GMP-certified cannabis flower is available to Aussie patients. In the same breath, Tilray revealed the launch of its medical cannabis education platform for healthcare professionals in Australia and New Zealand. Interesting.
Yeah, interesting. The firm says the new product offering is approved under the Therapeutic Goods Administration's Special Access to Authorized Prescriber Scheme. The products include 1-to-1 balanced flower, mid-range, and high THC varieties. After listening to patient feedback and other learnings from Tilray operations in Germany, the offerings in Australia will meet consumer needs there, says Denise. Faltischek, chief staff strategy officer. I heard your little giggle. As medical cannabis demand increases worldwide, we remain committed to providing healthcare professionals and patients with safe and reliable access to the highest quality medical cannabis products. There you go. You can have the next slide.
Okay. And according to George Plimanakis, Tilray's general manager in Australia and New Zealand, cannabis education is paramount to everything we do and are therefore excited to offer healthcare professionals with the tools they need to learn about cannabis through our new e-learning platform. The company's new education platform is designed to help healthcare professionals understand the benefits of medical cannabis. Previously, Tilray says it's been educating practitioners at workshops, training hundreds in 2021. The firm also partners with several research institutions, including the Murdoch Children's Research Institute in Australia, which is using Tilray's products in experimental pediatric treatments for patients with intellectual conditions and severe behavioral problems. The government of New South Wales and the University of Sydney to develop treatments for chemotherapy-induced nausea, and another study with the university examining the effects of driving under the influence of cannabis.
Hmm.
Really? That's really interesting there.
Yeah. I mean, like whether you like and support, you know, the government licensed producers, like, I mean, and we all have different views on different ones, and that's understandable. Canada's making moves around the world.
Yep, definitely.
Yeah.
If they've missed the mark on being a leader in their own country, maybe they can be a leader internationally.
Yeah. Yes. And with that, we are heading over to, this is KCUR.org, KCUR 89.3. Reversing decision, Missouri Commission awards cannabis license to jilted applicant.
Yeah, this is a bit of an interesting story here. In a rare move, a Missouri commission granted a medical cannabis license to an applicant after discovering irregularities with how state regulators evaluated applications. The Missouri Department of Health and Senior Services, the DHSS, decided to forego appealing the ruling, announcing Tuesday that it had reached a settlement with the jilted applicant to end the litigation. The Missouri Administrative Hearing Commission on December 28th, granted NWGMO LLC a license to operate a cannabis cultivation facility. The commission's decision came after testimony and evidence portrayed Missouri's system for deciding who gets medical cannabis licenses as a rushed process informed by intentionally vague guidance with no opportunities to review the work for problems.
Yeah. The commission's decision, reported for the first time by the Missouri Independent and the Midwest Newsroom, surfaced new criticisms of how the DHSS and contractor it hired handled the scoring for thousands of medical cannabis license applications. Competition for licenses became fierce when the state capped the number of applications it would approve, and the NWGMO decision gave rare public insight into how the decision-making process laid out. A Russian spotty process it was. Hundreds of applicants have complained that the state's evaluation process, there are more than 500 pending appeals of rejected licenses, with many focusing on the work done by Wise Health Solutions, the firm DHSS picked to outsource the scoring of applications. Wise Health Solutions is a joint venture of Nevada-based Vercatius Compliance Solutions and Oxterdam University, an unaccredited college that claims to be the first institution in the United States that teaches cannabis-based curriculum.
So far, Wise Health Solutions has been paid more than $2 million by the state. NGWMO argues that that what Missouri got for that money was a rushed and spotty evaluation process. DHSS rejected NWGMO's application in 2019 after Wise Health Solutions' evaluation did not score the company's proposal high enough to receive one of the 60 cultivation licenses that Missouri would allow. Much of NGWMO's appeal was based on the fact that it's submitted two licenses with identical answers to questions that still receive different scores, even though Wise Health Solutions' own training manual said such an instance should never happen. NWGMO is affiliated with Nature's Grace and Wellness, whose website says it has operated a medical cannabis enterprise in Illinois since 2014. Its appeal gathered testimony from top officials from DHSS and Wise Health Solutions, as well as a former contractor involved in the scoring process.
Yeah, so it says here, no notes required. Christopher Jacobson was hired by Wise Health as a contractor to help evaluate applications. Looking over more than 1,000 between October 2019 and January 2020, he testified in a sworn declaration that his supervisor sometimes pushed him to meet deadlines, and that although the process called for him to be able to review his work for mistakes, that never happened. Jacobson admits making mistakes in reviewing NGWMO's application when he scored the same answers differently. Ooh, asked about giving nearly identical answers, a 10 on one application and a 7 on another. Jacobson said, if I had been asked after submitting, uploading the scores to self-correct the inconsistent scores as to these answers, I would have given both respective answers a 10. Okay, well, why did you score them differently in the first place? Jacobson took no notes to explain the discrepancies in his scores. That jibes with the training manual created by Wise Health that explicitly discouraged scorers from taking notes, scorers from taking notes, with the caveat notes are not required and not advised unless you feel you must explain an outlier or redirection.
The administrative hearing commission's ruling noted that none of the individuals scoring NGWMO's cultivation applications made any substantive notes regarding the details of their specific scoring criteria. The training manual also says it is of utmost importance that applications be scored consistently and that multiple applications containing the same answer should never receive a different score. Dale Sky Jones of Oaksterdam testified that Wise Health did not second-guess the individuals tasking with scoring applications, saying there wasn't much room to go back and check for consistency because the company was under a time crunch. Asked during a sworn deposition why a review of scores wasn't conducted to increase the chances of a scorer would catch and correct inconsistencies, Jones replied, "You'd have to ask the state that." Passing the buck.
Yeah. Amy Moore, deputy director of the medical cannabis program, testified that the state left scoring entirely up to Wise Health. The state didn't review Wise scoring, Moore testified, in order to ensure impartiality and confidentiality in its scoring system. Moore contends that changing inconsistent scores on its own would have just completely destroyed half of the system if we had decided to apply our own judgment and anything that's influencing us. Instead, the Administrative Hearing Commission concluded the state accepted Wise's scoring as accurate and performed no review of the scores for variances. Under questioning, Jacobson could not articulate an objective metric that he used to score applications, the Administrative Hearing Commission determined. All I remember, it was an overall, he testified, kind of an overall picture of everything that we were doing combined. And you know, with there, I think it was a security question or something like that. What?
Oh, man, this guy's talking all over the place. Unsurprisingly, Jacobson could not articulate a rigid formula to ascribe to his grading criteria, the Administrative Hearing Commission said in its ruling. And we suspect he never could, even while he was performing scoring. He applied his own subjective experience and did his best to be consistent while performing the immense task of scoring over 1,000 applications with intentionally vague guidance. Wow. The state tried to argue Jacobson's testimony was not credible, but the Administrative Hearing Commission roundly rejected that claim, noting that state regulators chose Wise Health to perform its scoring. It admitted Jacobson had the expertise needed to grade applications. This is the system the department created, the commission's ruling concluded, and it cannot now say that Jacobson is not credible. Wow.
Yeah. Lisa Cox, spokeswoman for the DHSS, said there were initially 857 appeals filed with the Administrative Hearing Commission over rejected medical cannabis licenses, with 529 still pending. The reduction by more than 300 is primarily due to cases being resolved in favor of the department, either by favorable decision upholding the denial of licenses or through dismissal by petitioners, she said. Everything's under scrutiny. The Administrative Hearing Commission has previously only overruled DHSS and awarded licenses on three occasions. Last year, the commission awarded Haya LLC two cultivation licenses for Kirksville and Exelo on the grounds of scoring errors in the original application process. The state appealed the decision, but eventually settled and issued Haya the two licenses. In the five instances the Administrative Hearing Commission awarded licenses, the department, through good faith discussions with these petitioners, settled the matters and will work with each of them on operationalize the facilities as soon as possible, Cox said in an email. Wise Health Solutions has previously been scrutinized for its work in Missouri. Other spurned applications have alleged that partners with Wise Health Solutions have been consulting with their applications before DHSS hired the company to help regulate the license applications.
Yeah, one company, GMT Consulting, sued Wise Health Solutions, accusing it of negligence in its work with DHSS. The St. Louis Post-Dispatch reported last year that GMT Consulting won an arbitration award of $28 million. GMT Consulting is now suing Wise Health Solutions insurer to have it pay the award. In 2020, counsel for Missouri House Democrats wrote a memo that claimed Wise Health Solutions had conflicts of interest and went further to accuse DHSS and the office of Governor Mike Parson of improperly influencing the medical cannabis program. Parson denied the applications. Wow, this is a big, huge bungle of a mess, it looks like.
Yeah. Yeah, I wouldn't want to be the person that's in charge of trying to fix that.
No,
not at all. Sounds like nobody can really get their stories quite straight.
Yeah, and everyone's blaming the other person.
Yeah. Well, I saw this next story and I got kind of excited because when I first heard of these ladies, I actually thought it was a joke somebody was putting together, and it turned out that nope, it was no joke. It was absolutely true. We're popping over to High Times, and Sisters of the Valley plan to mail 13,000 hemp seeds to 1,000 customers.
Yeah, perhaps due to fate, the Sisters of the Valley, the nun-like hemp bearers of Central Valley, California, are mailing approximately 13,000 high CBD hemp souvenir seeds to 1,000 customers under a new program designed as a thank you to their customer base. The sisters are pulling a list on February 1st from their store of the last 1,000 customers who purchased from them, and each of them will receive a thank you card and a package of hemp seeds in the mail this spring. They expect to send out 500 in February and another 500 in March. The Wee Bairn seed strain was born of adversity as the sisters were under the threat of having their crops pulled out due to a sudden local law change that appeared to impact their farm. The sisters let the males live, go to seed, and ended up with their own proprietary CBD-rich seed strain. The seeds are not guaranteed feminized, nor are they guaranteed anything else, but customers report decent cannabinoid levels from the seeds. Wow, that's really cool.
Yeah.
That's really
neat. Yeah. For a brief moment in time, 2018 to 2019, they made it illegal to grow anything less than 20 acres, Sister Kate told High Times. So when they first opened up the hemp laws, they said, okay, but you have to have 30 acres. So here we were, and we've already had 3 to 4 years into operating and every year growing a big crop in our backyard, a 1 acre farm. So we can't grow more than like an eighth of an acre outside, so it's not a lot of plants. Sister Kate let the males go to seed, thinking they were bound to get ripped anyway, but their crop never became an issue, and the 20-acre law was dropped. By then, the sisters had given birth to their own proprietary strain of hemp, unplanned. The wee barren seeds were bred from plants of only high CBD strains that had been bred with other hemp strains, Charlotte's Web, Susie Q, Cherry Pie, and Remedy, to be precise. Hemp and cannabis farmers in California are already burdened with regulations and taxes that make business nearly impossible. Adversity is nothing new for the sisters. The sisters, for instance, battled the city of Marist in 2016 in order to keep growing hemp, which is really cool.
The sisters have been giving away seeds with bigger bundle purchases of their salve and tinctures since 2019. Customers who grow the plant and have it tested report getting from 12 to 1 THC to CBD ratio to as wonderful as a perfect 1-to-1, which the higher path calls the golden ratio. It's very interesting. The person who tested the flower at a perfect 1-to-1 was a Catholic nun. Sister Kate laughed. That's pretty cool. The sisters, of course, are in no way affiliated with the Catholic Church. Before becoming Sister Kale, Christine Musin, her birth name, followed advice from a doctor to use cannabis to treat symptoms of menopause. We're not in the seed business, Sister Kate said. We never felt it was right to sell them for very much, but we did sell them for about $3 to $4 a seed and put them in bundles. We gave them away in bundles and products. Now we have so many, and with COVID causing a scare on some people, we thought it was a good idea just to get the seeds out of the house and to say thank you to our customers.
Absolutely. She explained the benefits of the strain rich in CBD and THC, which often need to work together, synergistically, where we are always seeking the 10-to-1 or 12-to-1 ratio CBD to THC as the best for our products. But neurologists and people dealing with illnesses prefer the 1-to-1 ratio, said Sister Kate. In order to make $1 million in sales in a year, the sisters need 1,000 customers to spend $100 a year in the Sisters of the Valley store, which is the model she would like to build other sisterhoods upon. This is our thank you to the 1,000 customers who would buy from us every year, she said. We aren't shipping internationally, said Sister Sophia, because firstly, there won't be a lot of them since our international sales have fallen from 20% to 3% during COVID. And secondly, we don't want to get anyone in trouble. We will reach out to those international customers and see if they want us to mail them before we do. Sister Quinn added, we have a strong calling to be the Johnny Appleseed of the hemp industry and share our seeds. If we could sell them, we could make $1 million, but the seeds were a gift to us from the goddess, and we need to re-gift them to the people.
That's pretty cool. Sister Quinn and her other sisters used to take seeds along during bike riding to spread along the canals and let nature take her course, but she said they never saw any plants sprouting. I suspect that the surrounding Mennonite farmers pull them as soon as they are recognizable, or maybe the dogs eat them, said Sister Quinn. Mailing them to customers who already appreciate the medicine is a more certain way of knowing those seeds will be nurtured.
Absolutely.
Absolutely, yes.
That's pretty cool.
That is a really cool story.
Yeah. No, these ladies they're pretty epic. I have loved the stories that pop up from them from time to time.
And that story popped up there.
Yeah. We're heading over to Ganjapanor. Hempcrete insulation submitted for U.S. building codes.
Yeah. The U.S. Hemp Building Foundation, the nonprofit arm of the U.S. Hemp Building Association, earlier this month submitted hempcrete insulation for certification in U.S. building codes. Hemp Build Mag reports the hemp and lime material was submitted as an appendix in the International Residential Codes. In an interview with Hemp Build Mag, USHBA President Jacob Woodell said the submission documents will show a pathway for using hempcrete as a building material. That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
International residential codes experts are expected to evaluate the paperwork in March and again in September, the report says. If approved and included in the international residential codes, it would allow for hempcrete to be accessible to the standard person to construct with. Waddell told Hemp Build Mag, under current U.S. codes, builders, engineers, and architects must get approval to use hempcrete on a project-by-project basis, although the material is commonly used in the United Kingdom and France and has been approved for use for 30 years in Europe, according to Hemp Build Mag.
Well, that's really cool. I mean, like, I would love to see hempcrete actually become more of a thing. I mean, like, I would have used it if it had, you know, it's in hemp. Like, I mean, every 4 months you get a new crop versus having to wait 40 years with a tree, right? The certification process opens the door to apply for hempcrete certification in the International Building Codes for commercial buildings in 2024. When the next application begins, the U.S. HBA President Waddell said in the Hemp Build Mag interview. Submitting to the IRC is just the first step in a very long process to get hempcrete where we're able to use it more readily.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
It's
going to be available to the general public. I was just going to say, if I could go out and get, I know this is for the U.S., but I could go out and get hempcrete at the lumber yard or whatever, hey, I'd use it.
Absolutely. When it first comes out, it's going to be a little bit more expensive.
Yep.
And it's one of those things that will drop in price as it becomes more popular and whatnot. But I'm excited. It's also going to be better for the environment. But that was five stories. So with that, it's medication time, which means we're going to go have a word from our sponsors and pay some bills. And then Ron and I will be right back after the break. This is the Reefer Reporters, and we are live here at PaceRadio.net.
You're listening to the Pace Radio Network. Here at PaceRadio.net.
Growing your own cannabis is easier than you think. Whether you're growing for recreational or medical purposes, BMA Hydroponics has everything you need to succeed. From the standard four-plant recreational systems to the latest cutting-edge hydroponic equipment, BMA can customize your package and do it at discount prices. Visit BMA Hydroponics at 404 Maitland Drive in Belleville and ask us for a free estimate. Or call 613-967-9888, and we will give you an estimate over the phone. The only way to go.
A doctor's job is to relieve your pains. And when it comes to growing cannabis, the biggest pain is trimming. Let Dr. Buck Cannabis Trimming Solutions take the pain away. Whether you're a home grower or a commercial operation, we have the cure. From four plants to 400 plants, garden size doesn't matter. Dr. Buck Cannabis Trimming Solutions comes to you with years of experience and professional discreet service. It's simple. We trim your weed and we do a damn good job. Visit drbuckcts.com to book your trimming.
What do you find at PaceRadio.net? People advocating cannabis education.
CTCP operates a medicinal cannabis signing clinic. If you want to grow your own medicinal cannabis and are located anywhere in Canada, then I'd like to suggest that you give them a call. They can be reached at 1-613-967-9888. That's 1-613-967-9888. And grow on with CTCP.
At Legacy 420, we believe in being different.
Experience the difference of quality control.
Our labs provide tested formulations for all of our products.
Experience the difference in trust.
Our customers can trust that we are following up-to-date COVID precautions for their safety.
Experience the difference in accessibility.
We're open 7 days a week. Please visit our website, legacy420.com, or contact us for curbside pickup as well as nationwide mail order shipping.
Legacy 420 values overall wellness.
Come and experience the difference of Legacy 420.
The People Advocating Cannabis Education Radio Network, found at PaceRadio.net, provides its listeners with news, information, and a place to be heard. This is done through our 5 weekly live video and audio broadcasts that cover cannabis and psychedelic news, plus those we interview. We get started Monday at 10 a.m. Eastern with the Reefer Reporters. Then at 9 p.m. we're live with Canna Quebec. Tuesday brings you Open Your Eye or the Psychedelic Reporters at 7 p.m. Wednesday at 8, we are live with the Pace Radio Show. But we're not done yet. because on Thursday, the Reefer Reporters return with another Reefer Report. Meanwhile, once a month, Thursdays bring you The Grassroots Advocate, the Pace Radio Network's audio magazine. All these shows, plus more, are found right here on PaceRadio.net.
You're listening to the Pace Radio Network, here at PaceRadio.net.
Ha! And we're back.
We are.
We are back from our medication session, and we are the Reefer Reporters. And if you're not sure, yeah, we're live here at PaceRadio.net.
And if you miss our live shows, don't forget that they are available afterwards as a podcast on our website or on audio apps such as Spreaker, Spotify, CastBox, SoundCloud Plus, as Google and Apple Podcasts.
Absolutely. There's all kinds of them out there. And I just want to give a shout out to Carolyn. Good morning, sweetheart. We see you there. I hope you are having a wonderful day. And thanks for joining us here at the Reefer Reporters.
Yes. Good morning, Carolyn, and everyone else who may be out there.
Who may be out there of all the other people listening. Yes. So we are on to the next five stories, and we are heading over to Eureka Alert. Active ingredient in cannabis protects aging brain cells.
Yeah, this is I think this is interesting here. Decades of research on medical cannabis has focused on the compounds THC and CBD in clinical applications, but less known, but less is known about the therapeutic properties of cannabinol, CBN. Now, a new study by Salk scientists show how CBN can protect nerve cells from oxidative damage, a nerve pathway to cell death. The findings, published online January 6, 2022, in the journal Free Radical Biology and Medicine, suggest CBN has the potential for treating age-related neurodegenerative diseases like Alzheimer's. We've found that cannabinol protects neurons from oxidative stress and cell death, two of the major contributors to Alzheimer's, says senior author Pamela Mahar, a research professor and head of Salk Cellular Neurobiology Laboratory. That's a mouthful. Yeah. Discovery could one day lead to the development of new therapeutics for treating the disease and other neurodegenerative disorders like Parkinson's disease. Cannabinoid therapy, I think, is the way of the future.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think that's why we have a longer lifespan these days.
Yeah.
It's because more of us are taking it, and we're working on our endocannabinoid system. And this is one of the results, is that it treats things like Alzheimer's.
Yeah. Perfect example is good old Willie Nelson.
Yeah. Yeah. Look at him. Look at how fantastic he's doing. Right.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
He's in his 80s, I think, something like that.
Yeah. And he's got a 20-year-old son.
Wow.
Yeah. It's pretty. Derived from the cannabis plant. Well, the son in his 20s, his youngest is in his 20s. Yeah. Anyway, had him like at 60 or something. Wow. Derived from the cannabis plant, CBN is molecularly similar to THC, but not psychoactive. It's also less heavily regulated by the FDA. Previous research by Mahar's lab found that CBN had neuroprotective properties. It also helps you go to sleep. But it wasn't clear how it worked. Now, the new study explains the mechanism through which CBN protects brain cells from damage and death. Mahar's team looked at the process of oxytocin, also called furapatosis. Oh, goody. Yay, Cindy. Which
you did good.
Thank you. I'm always good for a laugh on the big words. What? Which is thought to occur in the aging brain. Growing evidence suggests that the oxytocin may be cause of Alzheimer's disease. Oxytocin can be triggered by the gradual loss of an antioxidant called glutathione, causing neural cell damage and death via lipid oxidation. I was taught in school, we have a sheath that covers a lot of these nerves, and that's what it does. It like this oxidation destroys the sheath, which in turn causes Alzheimer's. So in the study, the scientists treat nerve cells with CBN and then introduce an agent to stimulate oxidative damage. So I find it really interesting that like they're narrowing down the cannabinoid that narrows in on that and can help people that are predisposed to diseases such as Alzheimer's.
Yeah, as a preventive treatment, especially I think would be great.
Yeah.
They further found that CBN worked by protecting mitochondria, the cell's powerhouses within the neurons. In damaged cells, oxidation caused the mitochondria to curl up like donuts, a change that's also seen in aging cells taken from the brains of people with Alzheimer's disease. Treating cells with CBN prevented the mitochondria from curling up and kept them functioning well. Very interesting. To confirm the interaction between CBN and mitochondria, researchers then replicated the experiment in nerve cells that had the mitochondria removed. In these cells, CBN no longer demonstrated its protective effect. We were able to directly show the maintenance of mitochondrial function was specifically required for the protective effects of the compound, Mahar said. Interesting.
Yeah. Yeah. And another key finding, researchers show that CBN did not activate cannabinoid receptors, which are required for cannabinoids to produce psychoactive response. Thus, CBN therapeutics would work without causing the individual to become high. CBN is not a controlled substance like THC, the psychotropic compound in cannabis. The evidence has shown that CBN is safe in animals and humans. And because CBN works independently of cannabinoid receptors, CBN could also work in a wide variety of cells with ample therapeutic potential, says first author Zibon Lang, a postdoctoral fellow in the Mahar lab. In addition to Alzheimer's, the findings have implications for neurodegenerative diseases such as Parkinson's. We've seen there's an actor, a Canadian actor. Oh my gosh!
Michael J. Fox.
Thank you. I can remember Michael. I could remember his last name. And he has been very outgoing with his cannabis use to help his Parkinson's disease. Which is also linked to a gluten phone loss. Mitochondrial dysfunction is implicated in changes in various tissues, not just in the brain and aging. So the fact that this compound is able to maintain mitochondrial function suggests it could have more benefits beyond the context of Alzheimer's disease, Mahar said.
Wow. A lot of this is just repeating what a lot of people have been anecdotal stories and that, but it's nice to see the stuff coming out in actual official studies that are recent too. And that people are actually seriously looking into all this. Nice to see. Mahar adds that the study shows the need for further research into CBN and other lesser studied cannabinoids. As a next step, Mahar's team is working to see if they can reproduce their results in a preclinical mouse model. Other authors of the study on the study are David Soriano Castell, Devin Kepsla, Antonio Curles, and David Schubert from Salk, and Brendan Duggan from the University of California, San Diego. This work was funded by the National Institutes of Health, the Paul F. Glenn Center for Biology of Aging Research at the Salk Institute, an innovation ward from the Salk Institute, the Shealy Foundation, and the Bundy Foundation and the University of California, San Diego.
Yeah. So they tell you a little bit about the Salk Institute there. And then you can see the article title and the date that it was publicized. Very interesting information. I'm so excited to see that, studies that the government and the doctors can grab onto are happening and making everybody happy so everybody can finally get on board.
Yep, definitely. Definitely.
Absolutely. Heading over to Mugglehead Magazine. Amazon still doing their 180 turn. Amazon endorses the GOP cannabis legalization bill.
Yeah, one of the largest companies in the world is backing the Republican-led effort to federally legalize and tax cannabis in the U.S. On Tuesday, Amazon.com endorsed Representative Nancy Mace's States Reform Act, again showing off its support for reforming the country's cannabis laws. Like so many in this country, we believe it's time to reform the nation's cannabis policy, and Amazon is committed to helping lead the effort, says Brian Huseman, Amazon's vice president of public policy. We've made changes to our business. We support the MORE Act, as well as the Cannabis Administration and Opportunity Act, which is the COA, he explained in a statement.
We are encouraged by the introduction of the States Reform Act, championed by Representative Mace. This bill offers comprehensive reform that speaks to the emergence of a bipartisan consensus to end the federal prohibition of cannabis. Mace presented the legalization, the legislation in November, calling the proposal a compromise bill that ties in elements from Republican and Democrat filings. If passed, cannabis would be regulated by federal agencies similar to alcohol with a 3% excise tax and restrictions on advertising. The bill would ensure that state cannabis programs are protected under federal law. And I'm kind of giggling in my own brain because you know, they similar to alcohol and restrictions on advertising is kind of what kicked it off in the United States. When they have alcohol ads, you can be sure that you can show the product, you can pour the product, you can do whatever. You cannot drink the product on air. So I just had like a gajillion cannabis ads go through my head of not actually smoking it. Right.
Yeah. Yeah, so similar to some state-level cannabis bills, the State's Reform Act would expunge nonviolent cannabis charges. Small businesses would be protected, and local businesses would be promoted under the proposal. Mace has said that if the bill were to pass, there wouldn't be the need for the Safe Banking Act, which hasn't been able to clear the Senate despite several attempts.
Yeah.
Amazon, excuse me. Amazon began championing cannabis reform last summer. It's since registered to lobby for those issues while ending its policy on drug screening for cannabis. And I'm going to have you take over from here for a minute.
No worries. I just had to go through that. Advocates have urged other employers to follow Amazon's lead of dropping employee testing. In September, Amazon's sent a letter to senators who proposed the COA Act, saying it was an important change that could provide economic opportunities and start to repair the harm done by prohibition. Hussman also wrote in support of Congress acting to erase nonviolent cannabis charges and allow for resentencing. An Amazon spokesperson confirms with Mugglehead the company has no plans to grow, sell, or distribute cannabis products in our marketplace at this time. It's always at this time, because at this time leaves it open for the ability to say, well, it's no longer that time. It's this time, and now we're going to do it.
And you know that it will happen.
Oh, gosh, yeah. No, he sees dollar bills, y'all.
See, they've got an incentive to push through on all this stuff because this regulations, once the regulations allow, they'll be able to do it.
Yeah.
So you know it's coming.
So yeah, it's not at this time. Well, of course not at this time because it's not legal at this time. But you know, we all know what he sees. He sees dollar bills and a money making opportunity and just like any business person looking at it from the outside.
It's what business is about.
Yep, absolutely. We are heading over to the Scottish Sun. Look at these two fellows here. Gone to pot. Shetland's man, medical cannabis prescription seized by cops who refused to return it and threatened to charge him.
Wow. Yeah, Liam Lewis, 29, has been left distraught after his monthly delivery was intercepted by cops using a sniffer dog at a mail sorting office in Lerwick, Shetland, on Saturday morning. The 29-year-old, who suffers from functional neurological disorder, only discovered there was an issue when his mail delivery note said it had been delivered, And when he checked, he was told that it had been confiscated by officers. After attending the local police station on the island to provide proof the oil was legally prescribed, he was told that didn't make any difference and claims they refused to give him his medication. Even after producing an ID card to confirm he is entitled to the cannabis oil, officers still wouldn't hand over the medication and now look likely to charge him for drug possession. He blasted cops as he now has no medication to treat his debilitating condition. He said, "I have been left totally distraught by what has happened. It's outrageous. I now have no oil left, and it looks like I won't get this stuff back, so I am left in the lurch and face a horrendous few weeks until I can get another delivery."
Breaks my heart. Normally, my delivery is made by courier, but for the past few months, it has been delivered by Royal Mail due to worries about the boats to Lerwick being canceled. Gosh, my heart's just breaking for him. Mm-hmm. This was my third delivery this way, and there was never an issue with the others. I just can't believe they are talking about charging me over it. If I get charged, I won't be allowed my prescription for months. So, like, they're putting him through hell for 3 weeks, and they could put him through hell for months. After exploring various treatments for his functional neurological disorder, doctors referred Mr. Lewis to a specialist in London to trial the cannabis oil treatment in 2020. Since then, he has ordered his monthly prescriptions from specialist doctors at the Sapphire Medical Clinic in Harley Street, London. So he's getting it from doctors, right?
Yeah.
Mr. Lewis now pays £165 for the meds and says the oils allow him to do everyday things and lead a life without the painful migraines. He added, "I really need this medication as it helps me alleviate my migraines, which are debilitating when they start. I have tried all sorts of treatments on the NHS and none of them work. This is the only thing that works. I don't know what I will do if they don't give it back to me and charge me."
Wow, that is so sad.
It's heartbreaking.
It is. It is. Yeah. I couldn't even imagine me going without my medicine.
No.
It's
no.
Just thinking about it gives me anxiety.
Yeah. 100%.
Yeah, and it goes on here to say medical cannabis was legalized in the UK in November 2018. And doctors are allowed to prescribe it in certain situations. So this guy's like, he's legal. And the cops don't give a damn.
No.
Wow, I hope this guy sues.
Yep.
Or finds a good lawyer or something. Wow.
Yeah. The 2018 law change moved cannabis from Schedule 1 under the misuse of drugs regulations in 2001, meaning it had no therapeutical value, to Schedule 2. It now means doctors can prescribe the drug in certain situations. A spokesperson from Sapphire Medical Clinic's comments, "We are unable to comment on individual cases due to patient confidentiality. However, it's important to highlight that medical cannabis was legalized for prescription in November 2018 across the UK. As the only medical cannabis clinic registered by Healthcare Improvement Scotland, we abide by the stringent regulations, which include assessment by the specialist doctor and the requirement that the prescriptions are dispensed by an approved licensed pharmacy."
Are you there? I think you might have dropped, Cindy.
I'm here.
Oh, you're there. You're there. Yeah, that's, wow. This guy did everything that he was supposed to do, and he screwed.
Yeah, yeah, no, it breaks my heart. Come on, mouse, get in the right place. Yeah, no, it's terrible what they're doing to him. They have reached out to the Scotland Police for comment, but nobody has gotten back to them. So it's sad. Yeah. And we're heading over to High Times. The European Union cannabis consumption increased and ecstasy use decreased in 2021.
Wow. Okay, so let's see what this has to say. New survey studying the consumption habits of participants in the European Union reveal that cannabis use has increased and the use of, that's just kind of a repeat of what you just read, has increased and the use of ecstasy has decreased considerably. The European Monitoring Center for Drugs and Drug Addiction recently found that cannabis and ecstasy saw the strongest changes in consumption habits. The European Web Survey on Drugs was conducted online between March and April 2021 with the intention of illuminating patterns of drug use to consider in future regulation. Throughout 21 EU countries and 9 non-EU countries, the survey recorded answers from those who were 18 or older and had used drugs. The survey results, published on January 20, recorded the drug use breakdown of 40 of the 48,469 participants. Cannabis was the drug most used drug, with 93% of survey respondents reporting to have used it in the previous 12 months, and with little variation between countries. The survey results state. MDMA ecstasy, 35%. Cocaine was at 35%. And amphetamine, 28%, were the next most reported illicit substances, with the order of the three drugs varying by country. And around a third of respondents, 32%, reported using more herbal cannabis, and 42% using less MDMA ecstasy. Wow, those numbers are drastic there.
Yeah.
Anyways, the results also show that the group of participants had used LSD 20% and a new psychoactive substance 16%. Ketamine was at 13% and heroin sat at 3%.
Hmm. Furthermore, participants from the Western Balkans, which is made up of Albania, Bosnia, Herzegovina, North Macedonia, Montenegro, Serbia, and Kosovo also echo the high consumption of cannabis and decreased use in other substances, especially ecstasy. Most respondents, 91% of them, reported using cannabis in the previous 12 months, followed by cocaine, MDMA. You can see the percentages there. And my mouth isn't letting me say it. around a third of respondents reported using more herbal cannabis and 34% using less MDMA. In terms of where, and I still can't say it. I went back to say it again just to try it and it won't let me. In terms of where these substances are consumed, 85% of participants in the European Union and 72% in the Western Balkans use these substances at home rather than at public venues. It also takes into account that the motivation for cannabis use at home was because of multiple reasons. Participants wanted to relax, get high in order to improve sleep, but their use of MDMA or ecstasy was used to attain euphoric and socializing effects, which they haven't been doing during the pandemic. The study result breakdown states that the information shared by the 50,000 people included in the survey is just a small portion of the European Union, but still offers a useful glimpse into the changing habits of residents. While web surveys are not representative of the general population when carefully conducted and combined with traditional data collection methods, they can help paint a more detailed, realistic, and timely picture of the drug use and drug markets in Europe. Over 100 organizations took part in the initiative, including Retox, National Food Points, universities, and NGOs.
Yeah, and EMCDDA Director Alexis Gustiel shared a statement regarding the goal of the survey and the amount of participation needed from organizations to sort and analyze the data. Web surveys are a key ingredient in our monitoring of Europe's shifting drugs problem, Gustiel said. They help us reach an important target population through innovative online methods. Today's results reveal the wide variety of drugs available across Europe and provide valuable information on emerging trends and changing patterns of use during the COVID-19 pandemic. An impressive 100 organizations joined us at this time, building translating and disseminating the survey, ensuring that this is now an invaluable tool to help tailor our responses and shape future drug policies. Other studies in the U.S. have shed light on other topics related to cannabis, such as targeting teens with ads on social media, or an updated Gallup survey shows that a majority of Americans support legalization. And I believe those are links that you can click on in the article there, too, for those interested.
Absolutely. Yeah. Okay. Last story. We made it. Yay. Coming to us from UK Cannabis Campaigners. We are UK Cannabis Campaigners. Call on the, and this is not coming to us from UK Cannabis Campaign, at NME.com is where it's coming from. UK Cannabis Campaigners call on the government to consider sensible reforms.
UK Cannabis Campaigners have launched a new report which is calling on the government to consider sensible reforms of the UK's drug legislation. The report report follows on from London Mayor Sadiq Khan's recent plans to decriminalize some Class B drug offenses for under 25s as a part of a new scheme in the capital. Release, a UK charity, which is the National Center of Expertise on Drugs and Drugs Law, has now published a new report which is proposing 14 guiding social equity principles which should be integrated in the UK's future legal cannabis market, with recent public polls showing that over half of the British public support legalization of cannabis for recreational use. Release say that the reality is that cannabis reform in the UK is inevitable. And we see that all over the place.
Yeah. Among the 14 principles set out by Release in the report are removing criminal or civil sanctions for use of or possession of cannabis, regardless of its legal or, you know, illegal origin. The automatic expungement of past cannabis-related convictions, and permitting home cultivation of cannabis in the same way that individuals are currently allowed to brew their own beer. Absolutely. Dr. Laura Garius, the policy led at Release, said that the UK is trailing behind many other countries in terms of progression, progressing its drug reform. Despite unprecedented restrictions to movement and border closures as a result of the pandemic, the drug market remained remarkably stable, and indications are that drug use is increasing, not decreasing, she said.
Yeah, scrolling down here, the UK government's new drug strategy regurgitated a tough on drugs rhetoric, despite the Home Office's own research concluding that the estimated £1.6 billion spent per year on drug law enforcement is not impacting levels of drug use. Change is inevitable. Alistair Carmichael, MP, the Liberal Democrats' Home Affairs spokesperson, also called on the UK government to take power and money away from the criminal gangs by introducing a legal and regulated cannabis market, via iNews. The Conservatives' ideological war on drugs has not stopped the supply of harmful drugs. All they have done is concentrate power in the hands of organized criminals, he said. More and more countries around the world are leading the way on sensible reforms to drug laws. Under the Conservatives, the UK is trailing behind.
It actually is very, very much so. Them and Mexico, they're still, you know, dragging their heels. In response, the Home Office said, our first of its kind drug strategy will deliver a whole system approach, backed by record investment to tackle the problem at every single stage and address the underlying causes of crime head on. Back in November, Deftones launched their own cannabis collection. Oh, I don't think that's what, I think that's it.
Yeah, I think that's the end of the story there.
Yeah. So we got through the 10 of them. We did.
And on time, too.
Yeah, that's our Reefer Report for today, January 27th, 2022.
Yes, and weed like to thank you for joining us here at the Legacy420.com news desk.
Yes, yes, we sure would. Thanks for listening to our Global Reefer Report here at PaceRadio.net. And if you enjoyed it, please share it with those you love, even with those you don't. Have a great night, folks, or day.
Take care, all. Cheers.
The opinions of the individuals during this broadcast are their own and may not be the opinions of their group or other organizations they may be involved with.
You're listening to the Pace Radio Network here at PaceRadio.net.
BMA Hydroponics has everything you need to succeed. Visit our hydroponics superstore at 404 Maitland Drive in Belleville, and we'll show you how to grow your own quality cannabis for pennies per gram. We're open Mondays, Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and Saturdays from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m., and Thursdays and Fridays from 10 a.m. to 7 p.m. Call 613-967-9888. BMA Hydroponics, it's worth the drive. The only way.
At Legacy 420, we believe in being different.
Experience the difference of quality control.
Our labs provide tested formulations for all of our products.
Experience the difference in trust.
Our customers can trust that we are following up-to-date COVID precautions for their safety.
Experience the difference in accessibility.
We're open 7 days a week. Please visit our website, legacy420.com, or contact us for curbside pickup as well as nationwide mail order shipping.
Legacy 420 values overall wellness.
Come and experience the difference of Legacy 420.
Did you know that the Pace Radio Network isn't just a radio network? That's right, because most, but not all of our programming is now done via video and is then podcasted at paceradio.net. So if you want to watch, yes, watch our programming, you'll find us on the Pace Radio Network's Facebook page, plus the show's own page, and you'll find us live on the network's YouTube channel. And don't forget, you can find it all, video and audio, at paceradio.net.
A doctor's job is to relieve your pains. And when it comes to growing cannabis, the biggest pain is trimming. Let Dr. Buck Cannabis Trimming Solutions take the pain away. Whether you're a home grower or a commercial operation, we have the cure. From 4 plants to 400 plants, garden size doesn't matter. Dr. Buck Cannabis Trimming Solutions comes to you with years of experience and professional discreet service. It's simple. We trim your weed and we do a damn good job. Visit drbuckcts.com to book your trimming.
Enjoy the buzz of legalization with Campbellford Lifestyle Shop. From lights to plant nutrients, books, consumption accessories, and more, we've got all your basics to grow or consume cannabis. Visit our info center or take a look at our piercing services and body jewelry, now available in-store through Campbellford Lifestyle Shop, 17 Bridge Street West, Campbellford.
You're listening to the Pace Radio Network. Here at PaceRadio.net.